So it is my pleasure to present Professor Maria Bellido Millán. He is a professor of marine at the Spanish Institute of Oceanography, and he works in the fishery research team. His main research field are spatial modeling and stock assessment, but he has recently been involved in discard research and bycatch. He was the director of the Oceanographic Center in Murcia from 2009 to 2014, and he now teaches and supervises graduate students at the University of Alicante, where I once visited him. He is currently a visiting professor with us, Ulysses Hernandez. He will tell us about biogeography and spatial ecology and fisheries. Thank you very much.
First of all, I would like to thank the Institute for hosting me for the last 4 months. I'm here for a sabbatical research stay. And also, of course, to the CEO and our team for working in the data of this nice project. This is my talk. This is the structure of my talk. I'm going to be a little bit fast because I was told that there is a lecturer behind me. So I will start with presenting my institute and my expertise, and then I will introduce the concept of biogeography, spatial ecology, and marine spatial planning, why are they necessary, how to apply spatial tools, and some examples of my work. And then I will move to the marine spatial planning, the concept of ecosystem services, the scientific advice we provide for implementation of the marine spatial planning, and then an example and a brief conclusion. So I work in the Spanish Oceanographic Institute, particularly in the center, Oceanographic Center of Murcia, which is in the Mediterranean side, that's in that drum. The Spanish Oceanographic Institute is a national institution belongs to the Spanish government. Our main function is the research, but with a target to the advice for the different institutions, public, mainly public, sometimes also private, but mainly public, from the national, autonomic, and also local institutions. It's an institute with a multidisciplinary research. We have many teams, but maybe the most important and the strongest team is the fishing team, because the importance of historically of the fishing in Spain. Because our function, we try to target the research to provide useful results for advice also. And this is our main work. Regarding to myself, I do spatial modeling, mainly using spatial statistics and GIS tools. I also been implied in stock assessment groups in both Spanish seas, the Atlantic and the Mediterranean side. And in recent years, I'm getting more and more involved in this car and vehicle issues, because maybe you know that in Europe we are implementing a discard ban, and we have been required to make some advice to make possible that discard ban. So, as my institute, my research of the group I lead also serves as a support for giving advice. So what is biogeography, spatial ecology, and marine spatial? Biogeography is the discipline that studies the distribution of living beings in the world. It's a multidisciplinary research that receives funding from many other disciplines, such as biology, geography, zoology, ecology. Spatial ecology is the study of the interrelationships of different living beings between themselves and all their own environment. And it's very important that it's to study the spatial processes within the different spatial scales, local, regional, and global scale. And then marine spatial planning is a discipline, it's a management and planning discipline, which aims to manage the marine environment by assigning spaces to define and specific uses, either single or multiple uses. Why are spatial tools needed? This is a multidisciplinary approach, and they look for empirical relationship between the population size, the spatial distribution, and the oceanographic condition of the environment. Why? Because life always occurs in a defined space and time, and fishing fleet chase those fishing resources. So it's needed to know what the spatial scenario can be. However, the spatial temporal scenario dynamics, it has been often ignored by fishing managers. Sometimes this is because the lack of knowledge and the motivation of a spatial statistician to provide scientific advice, and also because another researcher don't know the appropriate techniques and they avoid that problem. So in our research, we applied the statistical and some other models called heuristical or computational, always on a spatial temporal basis. They are basically mapping tools and numerical analysis, and I'm going to introduce a little bit of it. What we get with that approach? We can get a complete and robust knowledge of the ecosystem dynamics. We can have estimates of abundance in a spatio-temporal basis. We will have a decrease in the uncertainty of qualitative assessment. We will now stand more on geographical pattern, flows, dispersion, concentration, and we know how the fleet and resource interact. We can have also a more deep knowledge of the distribution of vulnerable or sensitive species. We can have also the way to study some macro and mesoscale processes and the connectivity between the macro and the mesoscale. And finally, we can advise to managers on areas of particular importance for fishing or for protection, whatever. And where it's important in an institute like mine, because we are in the reference national institute in fishery research in Spain. There are some of them similar in Europe, in other countries, also in Canada for sure. And we have an history of more than 100 years and collecting data. So we have a lot of data, and we have a relatively well-organized databases with a lot of metadata, as they call it now. We have also a multidisciplinary research, which allows us to have an internal collaboration, but also external collaboration, because the institute is very old, and the fishing fleet, the Spanish fishing fleet, is quite spread around the world. And we are also the national body to develop some of the European directives, for example, those related to the marine spatial planning, in terms of the scientific advice. What we can get with this approach? We can study also the sources of variability in distribution and abundance, for example, the international interannual variability, but it's usually solved in the long and medium term, and it is basically related to the environment and fishing pressure as external factor, and recruitment, natural mortality, and the amount of the exponent are internal factors. And also study the variation in the medium short term, what we call interannual or seasonal variability. It is mostly related to the life cycle, seasonal effects, and possibly directionality of the fishing fleet. And we can also study the variability and the sources of the short medium term, more related to the spatial local movements. The species search for the most advantageous habitat, and there is an ecological competition for the stainless space. Why spatial tools are particularly important in the stock assessment? Because fishery managers usually like to have a total amount of fish for managing the stock. And the most standard, not all, but the most standard stock assessment model have ignored the importance of the possible spatial, geographic, and environmental effects. Here I'm saying, for example, this is a stock unit or whatever, it could be hay, cod, anchovy, and the standard stock assessment model, the prediction model, late age basis model, gives at the end they are very powerful and very robust, and gives you at the end a total amount of fish. But this fish is the sum of many individuals, and the spatial distribution can be very different. These are the most theoretical spatial distribution pattern, and basically they can be uniform, distributed, random, and complex. Most of the natural distributions are complex, and the driving factor could be death, spawning area, whatever. So to have a proper management, we cannot avoid that spatial distribution, because the fish is not uniform displayed, uniform spread out of the stock unit. For that, we need to know the spatial distribution of every fish, of every fish stock. How to apply spatial tools? But the most important is the scientific method. It's very obvious, but sometimes we forgot about that. It's basically a data analysis. We have to think about the problem and to suggest some hypotheses, so make the right question. Then we have to choose the more proper analysis to carry out that goal, so choosing the right model. And at the end, we will get some results. By a correct interpretation, we will have a final thesis. This sometimes is very obvious that I would like also to highlight, because we forgot about that, and sometimes we start the process by the analysis, and then without the question. So that is about it. So we use some kind of multivariate data sets. We use fishery dependent data, observer, fisher catch statistics, interviews. The most important characteristic of the fishery dependent data is the sampling. It's a targeted sampling. So you cannot use that sometimes for some estimation. And we also use feature independent data by research surveys, environmental data, geological data, pollution, current, whatever. The sampling of the feature independent data should be sometimes random, sometimes systematically, but it's not dependent of the fishing. We use also some data sources, so FAO, internet, official institutions, many of them. And I think very important of this research is as cheap research, because we add value to the existing data. In my research, we don't use to take new data and collection of data. So we add value to existing data. How we do this? By mapping tools, basically GIS, program, that is, or 3Ds. and using some statistics that are very important in this research, the distribution model, but we use also models. And in the last year, we are make some steps forward to some of the analysis and meta data analysis, data meaning, neural network. That this is a research that is developing, but not so established by the statistics research. So, fishery researchers sometimes have a lot of information, and sometimes he doesn't know how to cope with so many information. We have information with salinity, with power, and we don't know how to integrate that. My idea is it's a very easy way to have a well manage the data in different layers, and you can make some questions to the data for different layers and to search for relationship between the different layers. My hypothesis here, and you can test it by geostatistics, or you can test by general salinity models or any other model. And then, with the result you get, the model, you can plot it in the GIS. So at the end, it's a double way work. At the end, with this platform, you can have a very deep knowledge of the population dynamic, as this figure said. You can have a more easy platform to study distribution, fishing pattern, fishing ecology, whatever. Some examples, for example, this is from my PhD in Scotland. We found a relationship between the abundance and the distribution of the Scottish squid with the temperature and the seasonality. So by a GIS modeling, we define the annual cycle of the squid, which goes from a minimum reservoir in the summer, from June to July, in the west coast of Scotland. And it's progressing, and there is a migration, or better said, an occupation of more habitat in the maximum, which is in January and December. December and January. This was only done with searching for the preference habitat or temperature and depth of the squid. For example, in the Falkland Islands, we found a spawning area that wasn't defined earlier by searching on in the observer sampling station, the maturity stage of the important fish resort there, Micromyces australis. And that was used to establish then an spawning area for the Falkland government, Falkland Island government. With this GIS modeling, then you could have a lot of very nice maps. But if you want to go forward, you have to test hypothesis by statistics. We use a variety of methods. Some of them are non-parametric, other parametric, depending on the model. For example, a very flexible model is the general salinity model. Also, we use another kind of non-parametric technique, that is the regression trees, and geostatistics, particularly to know the spatial structure, and also to make at the end some interpolations by different trees. This, for example, is an example of a species distribution model. We identify the essential fish habitat of the anchovy in the Mediterranean Spanish coast and the deviants of every year from the general pattern. And also with a RDA analysis, we determine what are the most important variables to driving the habitat of the anchovy. But But we can use also other tendencies, not only a species distribution model. For example, we can use other spatial statistics to do map from mesoscale clusters. We understand mesoscale, the scale around 200 nautical miles, or in kilometers around 350 kilometers. So we can study the intra-connectivity, what is going from local to mesoscale. We have some studies about the divergences within a mesoscale range, for example, the divergences of the discard pattern in several ports in Spain. We have also some, by using also a species distribution model, we have done some hot spots or juveniles, like anchovies, but also by hake. And we can locate some persistent areas, and we can study some other concepts of ecology as metapopulation. Also, we can study the interconnectivity of some areas, from meso to meso and meso to macro. We have some studies using to study the trends of the mean trophic level in the Mediterranean and Black Sea, and a convergence of fishing patterns in different countries in the Mediterranean area, from developing countries to non-developing countries, to check if the fishing pattern at the end it goes to a convergence. Regarding the macro scale, we can study also secondary hiring processes, the connectivity of a large marine ecosystem. We have done some collaboration with EcoPark, particularly with my colleague Marta Coll, some of you know her, in Barcelona, in the city. And we also study some phenomena from biogeographical units to large marine ecosystems. In this case, we are using convergence and divergence analysis, and this is the main topic of my sabbatical stay here at the Institute. This sabbatical, I need to explain a little bit about my time here. This stay is funded by the Spanish Ministry of Education. My project research is so Daniel Pauli, because we have been in touch from some time ago with the relationship with the University of Alicante. And what I suggest here is an hypothesis that large marine ecosystem getting more and more uniform. So the second question are large marine ecosystem evolving to a worldwide homogeneity in functionality. You know that fishing down the food web theory, and there is a pelagication of the most of the large marine ecosystem. And we like to apply this convergence analysis. It's very powerful. It's a statistical tool mostly applied in economics, but it could be some useful technique also for environmental research, because it's search for different transition phases. So we gather the data by functional groups, the largest them is up, and we are still on progress. I made some heat maps by functional groups and some convergence analysis, and also trying some other multivariate analysis. But basically here is in a pure convergence, at the end, from the beginning, you will have a lot of modes. In a pure convergence, at the end you will have only one mod. So in this case, this is for the logic. There are several mods here. And from the 1950, this is 1950 to 1959, and this is 12 to 1214. So you see that there is a trend to get the same, a unique mod. We have to check, and it's still a problem, but the results are very, very, very nice. We have also some, in our research group, there are also some statisticians And we have also made some work to implement the statistical tools, particularly, for example, in a package which is called INLA. It's a new budgetary framework. Basically, the way of estimation, because it's a Laplace approximation. Most of the Bayesian some time ago was estimated by the Markov chain procedure, and this one is pretty more faster. So you can get, you can reduce a lot of computation time. With this, in this approach, we are doing a very nice work with about the preferential sampling in this distribution model, but it's very related to the whole development of IMLA. And we are making some step forward to computational metadata. We have a collaboration with some colleagues from the University of Alicante. So, what is this research aimed for? And, one of the best use of this research is to provide advice for marine spatial planning. Marine spatial planning is a public process of analyzing and allocating spatial and temporal distribution of human activities. It's not only for conservation, but to manage all the uses in the marine environment. This approach is quite new, relatively new. The first marine spatial planning workshop was held by UNESCO, an EU body, in Paris in 2006. And there is a common argument that the need of such an approach, but sometimes it's difficult to move the fishing managers to this kind of because the fishing management process is very slow. So, what is the ecosystem service? Ecosystem service is basically what the ecosystem can be part. In the marine environment, we can have many different uses. Extraction of non-renovable and renovable resources, including the aquaculture. There is a transit of people and merchandise ruled by national and international law. There are also areas of residence and enjoyment. And it's also started to new uses in the future. But now, for example, renewable energy, but we don't know in the future. So different uses can have many conflicts between users. They are also subject to environmental protection, but also some of them, some areas to some exploitation. And we need to provide the sustainability for the future. And particularly in fisheries, there are many conflicts over the use of space. There are very typical conflicts between different fishing gears, trawling, small scale gears, that limit marine protected areas, which species are vulnerable and where they are. So to implement a marine spatial planning, we need an advice. What is our duty? Our duty is to provide maps and easy indicators to help managers for a better decision making. We have to show awareness, support, and availability also to do that approach, because sometimes researchers are not very related to the management. So our work here is to transfer the research in a historic process. Here, for example, is a very typical project it's related to the discard ban and mitigation of discard. And here we have implemented a technological observer, which is this camera. It's on board, We can measure the fish on the bed, the fishing bed, and with the location and fishing gear characteristic of the fishing station, also characteristic of that point, we can send to that to the vessel and then to a server, and by a web service, you can, any user, a manager or fisher, can have maps. You can choose here the species you want a map. You can here the temporal range, and then you can have a map with a we define here a fishing index of suitability. What is the proportion of discards you can get in your catch? So the idea is to maximize the yield while minimizing the discard. So the green areas, the green point, are the best areas for fishing, where discard are less. This is for hake, this is for monkfish, and this is for different species. This is a tool that can help not only to the fishing manager but also to the fisher, because they can change their fishing strategy and they can adapt the fishing to the seller is expecting in the auction. We have many papers on that, and with the This I saw some here, but these ones are more related to this research, but we have many of them on sensitive species and that. Because of our work on the scientific advice, we have also some duties to attend some particular meetings. For example, I am the scientific representative for the Spanish National Table for Discard Mitigation, and we have to provide some reports about how the discard ban is implemented. And sometimes we have some more different advice, like, for example, the Fisheries Committee from the European Parliament. That we made some two reports, and now in autumn, in October, we have to do another one for the fisheries committee. And that's basically my talk. Very brief conclusion: the spatial planning now provides further insight to fishery manager. But to do that, we need to do modeling, both explanatory and predictive, for designing and forecasting such. Thank you.